I want to open it up to questions. If anybody has questions, just please raise your hand, and we'd love to hear from people. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Sumi Kawaratani, family physician in downtown Little Tokyo, and currently on staff at St. Vincent Medical Center, who's not represented on the panel. But my question to you, particularly the hospital providers present here today on our panel, thank you very much for being here. But what can hospitals do to promote healthy lifestyles, healthy behaviors, and access to the basic food, clothing, and shelter that a lot of the patients need to overall decrease illness and then cost of healthcare?
Boy, I just sound like a pessimist here, you know, at times. But Sumi, you know, I think one of our panelists said it, you know, do you get reimbursed for it? Hospitals are teetering right now. So the way we do it at Good Sam may be different, and that is we plan for it. Each year we do a community benefits program. We look out with community needs. So I'll take the Korean community in particular. We have to treat each one of these communities based upon cultural needs as well, besides medical needs. So we notice a high attempted suicide rate in our emergency department with Koreans. And we dive into this deeper with our clergy, with social workers and all. We find out that it's maybe for different reasons, that businesses have failed, students coming in that didn't get the right grades or whatever it is. So we set aside resources specifically for them. We give them free housing for centers to be able to intervene. Another way, every year we do an annual Korean health fair. And we bring in as much, it's packed, and we get volunteer doctors, they come in, the staff, and it is comprehensive. Anywhere, you know, pap smears, breast exams, we do blood work, we do everything. It's a lot of money out of the hospital's pocket. It's all for free. But I always say, each year, we always find probably 4 undetected cancer cases that had those patients not come through, which may have never been seen at all, much less in 10 years, the healthcare expense overall to the community, to the damage to the family with them and so forth, would be immense. So it's always worth it for us to just find that one patient in there. As it is, maybe unfortunately, we find a lot of things. We find diabetes, just all the other things, you know, congestive heart failure and so forth, and we have to go in from there to intervene as well. But it all costs money, and that's money so well spent versus, you know, stage 4 breast cancer, if you let it develop.
And I would just echo what Andy says, but I think it comes down to trust and knowing your community. We saw in the summertime, our census had gone down very, very low. I think this was during the time when there's a lot of uncertainty about citizenship status and documentation. I mean, one of the things we have to ask for is ID and social security numbers. And if our patients aren't even willing to do that, we've got a lot of work to do, even though, you know, we are no judgment, we are just there to treat. And now we're seeing patients who are, yeah, I'll ignore that chest pain one more day, or I know my sugars are high, but I'm not going to go in because I'm scared. I'm undocumented, and what's going to happen to me? And then you start seeing those patients when they do have those massive MIs or strokes. So I think it's really being very strategic, and I'm not a businessman, I'm a doctor. Hospitals' budgets are done on financial calendars. And when you're investing in the community, when you're looking at chronic disease, preventive medicine, that doesn't work. That doesn't look well on a financial calendar, on a fiscal year calendar. I mean, this takes years to build relationships with communities. And also being strategic, though, I think we're going to get into it about how we use data. Where are our patients coming from? Do we have some money, because we're a nonprofit system, to be more strategic of how we deploy those funds? Looks like a certain proportion of our patients are coming from this community or this census tract. Maybe we should partner with that church or that community group to find out what the health disparities are, and can we get to them before they get to our hospital? And then can we send them back safely? And I think having a really great partnership with our community, our foundation, that we are looking for opportunities and community partners. We have a multitude of relationships with the federally qualified health centers who are seeing the multitude of these patients. Can we get them earlier? I think, we see health outcomes that rival third world countries, right in our backyard. Things that you would never see here, but they're happening in our backyard.
This is a twist on that question, but I'm thinking about insurance companies. The only thing I ever receive from my insurance company is a bill. And I would think that they have a built-in financial incentive to make sure that I'm exercising, that I go in for a checkup, that I keep myself in good health. But again, I don't hear anything from my health insurance company. Any thoughts on that?
Harry should take that one.
Well, I will say if we had somebody here from Humana, for example, you would hear that the insurance companies have invested an enormous amount into wellness. Wellness has really been a challenge. It's been very, very hard to get engagement, so that's one challenge. And the other is, the question is, how do you get a patient, consumers to actually spend a little, right? And the insurance companies are always looking for participation and to get a little bit of skin in the game. Wellness has really been the big challenge. It's been a big promise, but it has not yet, we haven't figured out how to really engage. And I know there's a lot of work being done, but that's definitely a big frontier ahead.
Well, I'm gonna tell you that from our perspective, we've gotten a lot of interest from some major insurance companies in order to provide preventative mental health type of services, behavioral health services, to their members. And I'm gonna go back to the question about, which the doctor here presented earlier, and which was posed right now, about what is being done for preventative health. And I'm gonna stand on the technology soapbox for a second and tell you that I strongly believe that with the evolution of technology products, including bidirectional video, improvement in quality, improvement of access of internet, et cetera, preventative health and even curative health is going to take a leap forward. So whereas before this type of technology was being used for social media, it's now, and that's where it started evolving from, it's now made that leap. So what we see for employers now, health insurance companies, is that they are providing nutritional support, smoking cessation programs, therapy sessions, all of this through telemedicine as a way to improve their employees' healths overall. Like Harry said, there's a barrier there. And so what they're offering a lot of times are actually, from the employer standpoint, they're offering incentives. They're offering a discount on their health insurance, they're offering actual cash incentives, et cetera, to get people involved. But it works, and it really does work. And again, I'm gonna say the technology has been utilized very well for that preventative type of a program.
This is going to be the last question because I want to leave time for takeaway, but
please go ahead. Totally fine. First of all, I want to thank you for being here, and this is a vast subject, and we're hitting on a lot of the preventative nature of healthcare. And I don't envy you, because in the medical community, you get people at the worst case in their health cycle. They've been smoking and drinking and eating fried foods for 50 years, and they walk in with, glass-like veins, and you're supposed to give them a pill and fix them. I have been extremely active in practice alternative health practices for the last 35 years, and quite honestly try to stay as far away from medical as I can because of so many of the side effects from antibiotics and the drugs and whatnot. I also am very well aware of the pharmaceutical lobbies in Washington, D.C., and the amount of control that they actually have over what practices get practiced in the medical community. primarily medical can do three things. It can drug, cut, and radiate. Those are the three solutions that you have, yet there are hundreds of viable good solutions that are not included under the medical umbrella. Could you just address how you might be able to include other practices outside of that very restricted, licensed medical community that, that are viable in other countries around the world?
Yeah, I mean, sure. I think that thankfully there's some increasing enlightenment around the need to treat the whole person, and not just the whole person within the context of their family and their community. I think what I talked about with our palliative care team is really a good example where it's a team-based care, and we bring in people from all different specialties. Another service that we bring in with the palliative care that I didn't mention is we have integrative health specialists who come in and use yoga and meditation and energy therapy to help support the patients as well. So in that model, there's a lot more that the physician can do than cut, prescribe, and I can't remember your third one, but I got the point, radiate. I don't radiate, so I forgot that one. We can use an iPhone, but being a trusted advisor and a guide through a system, when a system really is centered around patient values and preferences, there is a lot more than a physician can do than those sort of three reductionist activities and really help guide people through the system.
Terrific. Shaf, I can put you on the spot. Any last takeaway, a final word? We'll come down to me.
I think that, as I said before, the advent and the movement forward in technology is going to be one more tool that we didn't have before in the improvement of healthcare, improving outcomes, preventative health, and lowering costs. I don't think it's the panacea, as Scott was saying, but it's something that even 5-7 years ago did not exist before. So it's going to be a very exciting time, you know, from a behavioral and mental health perspective. We're doing things that have never been before possible with much better outcomes, much lower cost structure. And I think that's going to spill over to healthcare in general, looking at the next one or two decades.
Yeah, it's interesting. As a geriatrician, I can't believe I've never gone this long without talking about the aging population. So I'll end there with the aging population as my closing thought. You know, I heard a statistic the other day that there are now 2/3 of the people over 65 that have ever been alive in the history of man are walking around this earth right now. Wow. Right? We've had a 30-year gain in life expectancy over the last century, which is unprecedented in human history. And with the boomers turning 65, 10,000 boomers turning 65 every day, we will soon reach a point where we have more people over the age of 65 than under the age of 18, an inversion of the population pyramid. So amidst a whole world of uncertainty, the one most certain thing is demographics. And what we know when we think about an aging population is that most 2/3 of older people have multiple chronic conditions. The system that we've been talking about today that's failing people isn't geared towards doing a good job taking care of complicated older people who take a long time and have multiple chronic conditions and need all of this whole person care and preventive care. So with that, I know I've gone up with Andy in terms of a little doom and gloom, but I'm actually very optimistic. I do think that the technological solutions are incredible. I think the pressure on employers to deal with these rising costs are a huge force. And I think that aging population moving through the system will just put a spotlight on our failure points and force the system to change. I think we'll all have to play a role in advocating and coming up with good solutions, but I think we are at a turning point and that the demographic factors will be a major force in tipping the hand.
Thanks. Joe, any last word? Takeaway.
Yeah, I just wanted to thank you all again for the opportunity for us to come here and let you talk to you about what it's like at the front lines. But I think also just the ask would be, you are all leaders and you have a lot of power. I mean, this is your community. how healthcare evolves, how healthcare in downtown LA evolves, you're really a lot a part of that and how that's going to be shaped. And I think not to forget our social contract with our community and remembering the members that the people that still live here, the people that lived here before all the skyscrapers, and how can we provide world-class healthcare to everybody, not regardless of what their insurance is or what their lot in life is.
Andy.
You know, there's that quote, I've been in this business 38 years, and there's the quote that there is no profit in curing the body if in the process you destroy the soul. And I think that's primarily what we've been talking about today, putting a little bit more soul into this. As Rotarians, we're really, I'm not one, but I've got half my brother over here is, but we're really on the same mission. He's a half a Rotarian, I guess. I don't know, half a something. So, but if you look at it, what you all try to do is improve the human condition. You try to maximize individual potential. And you do that through fabulous ways of traveling around the world, and it's through eyeglasses and immunizations and wheelchairs and a whole host of projects that you take on and you dive in. I know we can do this. I mean, I mean, you've got a generation right now that's kind of fed up with the way things have always been. They know how it's gamed. You're triumphant here of the quality of healthcare, accessibility, which we didn't talk a lot about, and then the cost. Those, you know, the 3 points that you hit there. This can be changed. There can be coverage for everyone. In a wealthy nation like this, the quality can improve. And certainly the access at the right points so that people aren't waiting to the very end before all systems have cratered and it's really expensive. So thank you.